whether the Unicorns of Valve are going to force the Copenhagen Wolves into a lane swap. Because the first match the Wolves played with this new roster, with the addition of Lenny and Cass, they were lost in the lane swap. They had no idea of what was going on, where they had to be, and they arrived late. And then, consequently, they were late in every single step.
Yeah, we were hearing from them how different the LCS is, and they're really just not able to keep up for it. Maybe this time they'll have had a little bit more experience in the bank. Taking a look at the bans, we've got the Ryze, the Sivir banned away, and of course the Draven by the Unicorns against Freeze.
Yeah, whereas at the start of the split, you had to keep your eyes on like Alistar, and maybe some supports like Thresh or Morgana right now. You mainly want to watch like Janna, you want to watch the Varus and the Jayce. This is Poke meta game. If you haven't watched LCS either in EU or NA, that's something you want to be expecting. And since both are up right now, there's still priority for the Copenhagen Wolves. Maybe pick something else, open just with an S tier jungler, you know, like a Gragas if they really want to. But we've seen that get punished around the globe so far as well.
Yeah, the jungle has been completely untouched with all these AD carries, except for the Nidalee that just comes in at the last moment. Does this now prompt? There's the Gragas. I was going to say that or maybe the Corki, but it's going to leave it open for Unicorns if they want it. Also, quite a lot available for Power of Evil if he does go a little bit more carry-centric route. We might see that later on in the pick, though. He doesn't have to take it now.
Yeah, the good thing for teams that are trying to combat Poke and don't want to play it themselves is that Poke compositions manifest themselves early in champ select. Usually build towards the, you know, the final Poke pick, and then you kind of reveal your strategy at the end, but it's kind of obvious that you're going for it. That means you can counter it with the likes of Hard Engage and something we saw, and Sustain that we saw over in North America. Gravity did that phenomenally. Obviously, you still have to play out, and you can obviously still lose, but let's see what approach the Unicorns are going to take. Usually, when the meta sets itself in a controlled state, they tend to shift away from it. It doesn't look like they're doing that today.
And they'll be going for something a little bit more standard, that's for sure. The Corki comes out from Vardags, and Hillisang will get his hands on Alistar. The Morgana ban was actually something that's happened a lot to Unicorns over this split. That's the 10th one people have sent away, the most banned champion versus Unicorns.
Yeah, definitely. If you just go back in time a little bit, maybe one split, that was when Hillisang was doing so phenomenally well with his Morgana. However, that was back when 2v2 laning was more predominant and there was more trading going on. And Hillisang and Vardex, they managed to kill almost every bot lane duo in the LCS back then. We don't see that from them usually as much recently. Very passive approach, and that's why Hillisang is roaming a lot more, which is why I like the Alistar, because I really feel him and Kikis can be the foundations of the mid game that Unicorns of Love can build on. And right now they have a very generic pick with the Alistar Corki. The good thing about it is that the Corki can sit in lane and farm when it's level 6 and you don't need the support to babysit that champion anymore. Yeah, could prove useful.
Yeah, we'll have to see if they're able to stay safe, stay nice and easy, adapt to this new style. That's what they've been liking. For the Wolves, they picked themselves up the Nautilus and the Lulu, and we talked about the possibility of a top Nautilus with the Lulu locked in. A lot of flexing going on for these Wolves. We'll see where they end up taking it as the Unicorns eyeball. Right now, this Kog'Maw would not be a surprise. Power had some pretty power plays on it early on in the split, but there's still some time on the clock as it ticks down.
Honestly, I feel locking in AP Kog'Maw here is a step backwards instead of forwards. With both Jayce and Varus open as AD Poke champions in the mid lane, and you always have that magic damage from the Corki lockdown, and I feel they scale quicker, or they have more impact in the game than the AP Kog'Maw, which is why we've seen a lot of teams just simply resort to these champions over the Kog'Maw. Not sure if this means that Power of Evil just doesn't play these champions at all, or whether he, in his mind, feels that Kog'Maw is stronger.
I mean, you had the Varus up, you had the Jayce up.
Yep.
There were a lot of options. Now they're going to be very committed to the mixed damage. You know, Power hasn't played this AP Kog'Maw for several weeks. I was saying early in the split, but now it goes right back to it.
Yeah, and if you look at the Wolves, they have a lot of flexing going on. So the Nautilus, well, it's not played yet in European LCS in the top lane, it could technically still go there. Lulu can be played mid, top, and support. So they're about to reveal their composition, and the Unicorns, they want to round that out then finally with their top lane pick. They leave it for Chachi, top lane carry that could technically bully his opponent. Chachi used to be in Spring Split one of the few top lane carries, but right now, you know, Oduwamne is stepping up a lot. We have Huni getting better as well, so all these carries in top lane, I mean, he's kind of fell down the rankings a bit.
Yeah, just a skosh now. So Victor's locked in. That should be Soren's pickup. And this means we still aren't 100% sure if the Lulu or the Nautilus is going to be going support. Mix it up. See what the options are for that. But for the Wolves then, they have quite the beefy frontline regardless to protect this Graves, protect this Victor. It'll be a tough task for the Unicorns to blow through that and mow them down.
All right, what are the Wolves doing? Usually when we see these teams with new players, they end up playing a mix of comfort picks over actual composition. So Blue top might be a comfort pick for Lenny here. Has a little chase potential, but not really hard engage. The hard engage is on Nautilus. It's technically on Gragas too. So now the Unicorns have to play defend the Kog'Maw. This is a very linear composition. If you look at what the Unicorns want to do, they have one big threat. That is Power Weave on that AP Kog'Maw. But he needs to scale. He needs time. But once he gets to that late game point, he's going to be able to poke everybody on the Wolves with relative ease. And then you have the defensive pinball system with the Alistar knockback. You have the Lee Sin kick. And then worst case, Shen can taunt in, provide an extra shield for Kog'Maw. But this is going to be the PoE show with the mid-game Band-Aid. That's going to be the Corki Vardax. I want to see if he can hit that Triforce Power Spike. Not like you usually would expect in this lineup. Usually once you hit Triforce Corki, you want to group up and, you know, start sieging. Perhaps Power Reveal is ready for Poke Siege then already, but they might probably just use the Power Spike from the Triforce to buy some time, get PoE rolling. But all your eyes should be on this mid lane matchup, and especially whether Shook's going to shut that down. I think if Shook can connect some Body Slams in the mid lane, repetitive ganks and Power Reveal, then the Wolves can snowball.
He's going to have to focus on that, keep his attention. Kickus will have to do the same thing that early game Lee Sin, see if he focuses on that mid lane or not. So with all that locked up, it'll be very exciting to see if the Wolves can maybe bring it back around, or will, of course, the Unicorns be the one to add to their kill tally? And we'll have to find out. We're about to load up onto the Rift, but why don't you guys at home tell us what you think? Hashtag CWin or hashtag UOLwin. Packed crowd in the house. Noise is getting hot here. Let's go, guys. Let's onto the Rift. It's going to be week number 7, starting off right now. Unicorns of Love and the Copenhagen Wolves.
I'm liking it, Pyra. Week 7, full house here in Berlin. Interesting matchup. Both teams have to prove something. The Wolves have to prove that they're making progression. Mm-hmm. We cut them some slack initially when they had that roster change. Right now, they should have improved. They should have practiced a full week, you know, get some games under their belts, learn what it's like to play on stage. Whereas the Unicorns, consistently shaky. We're gonna shake it off or plummet down below.
Well, they definitely have to beat the Copenhagen Wolves if they want a serious shot at these playoffs. All eyes on them as we have a dance party in the middle. Soren showing off his fancy footwork and Power Evil, the backside.
Wiggling his tail.
All right. I can't get the word.
Passive early game. And this is actually something interesting because we didn't used to see this so much. These wards in the mid lane, they look very generic, but I think it's more of an adaptation that came around this split more so. It was actually initially a reaction to put that ward in the mid lane, then free up your mid laner as a resource to move left or right for these aggressive invades. But even though Unicorns aren't doing anything, they still put those wards. It feels like a bit of a waste. If you're already scouting in the mid lane, I guess maybe they're giving the illusion that they could roam because they're staying out of the vision range, but at least they have the ward to see what's up.
It's all about the mind games, Crepo. Took a look just a moment ago. These teams last met. It was all the way back in week number 2, and it was a handy stomp for the Unicorns. They're going to be hoping to do that again.
Yeah, take a look at the early game. The way it's developed recently, it's the League of Double Jungle. You usually see everybody almost starting a camp, whether it's helping out. Perhaps not so often the mid laners. You have Vardex and Helisang setting up for that Gromp, and then Freeze and Kass. Boys to come and stop it. This is weird.
There is a ward on this. They'll be able to spot it when it happens. Kass reveals.
Oh, they can just finish that.
Goes. Yeah, they should be able to do this one. No, backing off. Let's see. Kass
yeah, finish
the ward.
It, finish it. Oh.
Oh, they got spooked.
Oh.
All right. So far, so good for the Wolves bot lane.
No cojones on the side of Unicorns of Love. If the support comes in his melee range, just finish it. Get level 2. Give full speed to the Alistar. Get level 2. Knock that guy back up, and you can punish that so hard. But bold move by the Wolves, and it pays off. And now Freeze. He got that initial experience in lane. Vardex got chunked. A big advantage right now for the Wolves in the bot lane.
Yeah, it's a great way to start. When you are on AD carry like Graves too, you want to push your advantage very quickly, see if you can bully your lane opponent out. Let's take a look at Vardax, however, in a couple of games he's had on this Corki in the summer split. Not too bad in the numbers.
Yeah, he does well. Corki just generally does all right, but Graves is a good matchup into it when it purely comes down to laning, because you can always dash out aggressively out of that Phosphorus Bomb, and then you don't have a threat from a double range support. And Nautilus is stronger when it comes to raw damage than Alistar. This is why in this matchup, very often, you see Alistar start heal, just tank the creeps and force the lane to push back. Yeah, Unicorns got greedy with the camp, didn't finish it. Wolves capitalized, but that's enough about the bot lane. We watched the junglers, I think both got a leash from their respective top laner. Shook's super healthy right now, level 3, so he could set up for a gank. But where's he gonna go? Mid lane is pushed in, top lane is pushed in, so double push, triple push for the Wolves. Standard scenario is, you counter jungle.
Yeah, let's see if he's able to do that as he heads his way into the same area where Kikis is hanging out, pings it down. No wards here to spot him just yet, and might be buying himself some time.
So yeah, this may seem minor, but because Kikis gets spotted here, allows over in the top lane Lenny to play aggressive again. Before, when the camera was on the top lane, we saw him move out of that couple CS, and he was afraid because Chachi was faking it. He was walking up, say, "Hey, dude, you're in my taunt range right now. You have to back off because my jungler could be here, and then you get punished." Right now, immediately once Kiki showed in the bottom, you see Lenny move up, and he's not afraid to play at the edge of the tower range. So information is a big resource in League of Legends, and just showing your jungle at the wrong time, you know, could snowball other lanes without really noticing it.
Yeah, he's going in, but you know, level
there's
four,
no backup.
Level four, they're just going to be able to poke each other out. It really is where the junglers can be and how well hidden they can keep themselves.
Yeah, and this is the natural progression, but Hillisang.
Yeah, he goes in on Freeze with Kikis and Vardax there. Freeze exhaust is on, a couple of flashes burnt, Phosphorus Bomb, not enough damage. Keep eating the biscuit, can't fast enough. That is going to be first blood over to Kikis as Cass just barely makes his escape. Should come late to the party.
I was about to comment on how that move from Kikis in the bot lane was too telegraphed. He was at the Grump earlier. His camps were down at the in that area, so the only logical move for him was to base or lane gank, and you could easily dodge that, but good Q flash from Hillisang. Nox freezed back sideways. He tried to angle himself to get him back into the lane, but if Hillisang took one more step, that would have given Freeze the time to flash, and then the headbutt would have actually knocked him into safety. So good headbutt timing there from Healy. Good follow-up from Kikis, and fundamental mistake here from Freeze, who's playing a very snowbally matchup. Graves needs to snowball that lane because in the mid-game, Corki Rockets are so much better, so much more useful.
The only consolation for the Copenhagen Wolves is that they got three summoners out of that, but all the same, your AD carry's dead. It evens out the advantage that Freeze had got himself early on by forcing Vardax back. This will definitely help out the bottom lane. Let's take a look at the others, though. That mid lane, we wanted to talk about it. There is a slight CS differential, but that tier on Kog'Maw is definitely going to be something Power can be very happy about for a while.
Yeah, he wants to stack that tier, but he yields the pressure. Top lane was yielding the pressure. Bot lane was yielding the pressure. So triple lane push for the Copenhagen Wolves. That was good. That you can translate that into objectives, vision control, but then you're not allowed to make the misstep because the only way you die when you're like pushing so far up is like these, you know, these cheeky little lane ganks with Alistar flashing. He has one engage tool, which is the pulverized flash. Because just normal combo is not enough damage at this point in the game to really punish somebody. So they made it stick, and that was fundamental for the Unicorns to buy enough time in this early game.
Even without that flash available for the next couple of minutes too, now Unicorns are going to be able to push out the wave themselves. You know, with Freeze, his build's been set back a little bit, having to get that secondary Doran, so Vardax and Hilly aren't too worried about this right now as they command the minions into the tower. Move themselves up. Let's see if they go for a roam here. They're going to spot the ward out, should be able to take it down. Deny the vision from the Wolves.
Yeah, they just want to put some wards here. They want to find Shook. So while Freeze is waiting for that BF sword after his double Dorns, Shook is looking for an opportunity, and he usually was the shining light in the early game for the Wolves. He was involved in quite some first bloods and some kills and some assassinations, but right now, because of the nature of the lanes, because they were pushing so hard, he had a hard time finding an opening, spotted the enemy jungler, but his team didn't use that information, so that was a waste of time in a sense. So now he just wants to get level 6. Find a body slam flash somewhere.
There's always a timer when you play an earlier pressure champion. The same thing can be true for Kikis, but he's very busy in the enemy jungle. Right now you've got the Gragas in the same though. See what he can get done. Just gonna be counter jungling each other.
Yeah, he's looking for Kikis. He's on the strong side of the map. He just warded it. So he saw that the Wolves just spawned. It indicates that Kikis was here, you know, a couple minutes ago, which means he's likely now on the left side of the map. This gives the safety for the bot lane for the Wolves to push up and play aggressive. I just wanna Have your eye, or take your gaze towards those three pink wards right now that the Wolves have set up. This is what you should do. When you play triple push, you back that up with a defensive line of vision with pink wards, and then you aggressively add a line of green wards in front of it, and then you have complete control of the map, and you use the fact that you have that early pressure to your advantage, and then you want to gain information. Has a jungler showed at these parts of the map? Good, we found him. Has he not showed at all in these parts of the map? Well, that means that he's on the other side. You know? You don't need to see somebody to know where he is, because if he doesn't show in the Wolves for quite a while, you know that he's likely on the other side of the map. And Unicorn's doing a good job here. I don't think Power of Evil should be able to get that blue buff just for free, but he does.
Yeah, we've seen this before. We've seen it again. Freeze this time. He doesn't get knocked back into the team or even sideways. He's able to make his escape. Shook is coming in now as well.
Yeah, and that's the difference with Alistar with Flash and Alistar without Flash. As Varda gets aggressed on here,
they're going
should be
it.
All right.
Hilly was in the front. He has his back with Shook there as well. Unicorns will know that they have to back off.
Remember, we have Shen Ult.
We might. Yeah, I don't think the dive is coming. Not with the Shen Ult or the teleport. Both of them available. Copenhagen Wolves know this. They'll back off.
And that's the difference between Alistar with Flash Up. He can Q Flash first, knock you back into the lane, buy enough distance for your AD carry to whittle you down, but just comboing efficient or aggressively waste the cooldowns of the Alistar. You really want to space out that headbutt and that pulverize to make use of an Alistar. That's why usually these lanes go 50-50, even CS with sustain, because offensive comboing costs too much mana for the value it brings you in lane. You just don't win anymore. There's no all-in lanes anymore.
Yeah, and as hard as the Wolves are trying to push in all of these lanes, they're not winning, at least in the CS department, of every single one of them. You take a look up top, we just saw Lenny and Visichachi. There's an 11 CS differential lead for the Shen, and he's the one who's under his own tower.
Yeah, Chachi got pushed in, but CS, well, he said, I don't really care about your poke. I have sustain. Look at the build path as well. Picks up the early magic resistance to deal with that Lulu, and Lenny needs to snowball that lane. Of course, he's going to be utility on the Lulu, so he just wants to help. Other carries on his team. Gray's relatively low mobility. The only person that's really using this push pressure to his advantage so far has been Sorin. And this was the matchup we were obviously talking about in the pregame.
Yeah. Well, the longer the game does go, the victor will get very, very powerful. He's definitely going to be happier if he doesn't get pushed in on. The junglers haven't really made too much attempts to pressure that mid lane. I think for obvious reasons, it's both a long-range thing. They're trying to play back as immobile as you might say these two champions are. So with all of that, they're just going to get the chance to scale up, and that's pretty much at the expense of everyone else on each team.
Yeah, definitely passive mid lane, and as you say right there, low mobility on both sides. Sorin, very stagnant, unless he can connect that Q for some movement speed boost. And now we see this, yeah, how Chachi is slowly getting ahead of this matchup. He doesn't have to care about the poke, and he can sustain with those Vorpal Blades. And then back to the mid lane at the other side, you have Power of Evil. Low mobility as well, but his range far exceeds that of Victor, especially once he hits that level 11. We always talk about it. Level 11, Luden's Echo. What you're looking
He's
for.
Getting there.
Power's well on his way. Game's relatively easy, even. 500 gold lead. Things to watch out for right now is the Triforce spike on Corki, and eventually the Luden spike on Power of Evil Kog'Maw.
Yes, indeed, and we'll have to be certain that the Wolves are keeping an eye on that as well. So look at this, though. Hilly and Kickus moving up to the top. They're close to sitting on this ward, however. And there is, of course, no Lulu to worry about.
I like it. Push it. I like it what the Wolves are doing. They're playing on their strong side of the map, but Chachi is winning the matchup. They can snowball that pressure into control, into vision control, and then into information. Whereas Corki in the bot lane, he can always farm into any matchup, I feel, and get 70% of the CS just due to the rockets, which is why he's such a good pick if you get through the laning phase. And back in spring, he wasn't that viable because he could get bullied out really easily by Lucian, by Graves, who were super meta back in the day. Right now, if you ban out Sivir and you ban out Kalista, and these other champions don't snowball that well enough, then Corki is a solid pick, because once he hits level 6, it frees up your support. You can put him anywhere. Put him in the top lane, dive the mid lane. The Unicorns might be setting up for right now.
Yeah, and it did deplete the field just a little bit too. You could see Freeze, he went on this Graves, which we hadn't seen very much for a while. Now, in the bottom lane,
Shen
comes Kass, Vardags, chasing it back. Shook is there. Shen already had come in. The teleport now. And in comes Shook out of the brushes. Freeze is there. Throws the big barrel out. Rolls it as well. And that's going to be Vardags going down. Visichachi might not have been wanting to teleport in there. All of a sudden, the pack of Wolves out of the brush. They get two, and they get the tower.
The Wolves put the party in participate when five members come down to the bot lane. This is naturally the counter against these wave clear champions that you can't really deal with 2v1. Just bring your entire team there. Dive him. Looked a little shaky at the start, and they were actually baited into playing forward. I think if the Wolves played this more conservative, just wait it out, don't go for the counter kill. Don't get that body slam flash connecting from Shook. That was a big difference right there. Could have turned out differently, but again, Shook with the opening. First two kills for the Wolves, he's involved yet again. Let's watch that. So what you're going to see here is Vardex knows he's about to get dove, so he wants to get out. So Kaz has to stop him. He has to commit. Shen Ulti gets baited, and now Kaz is acting like he's actually outnumbered. Flashes out for the possible taunt, but this body slam flash from Shook is honestly what makes this work. Chachi gets chunked, and Vardex just gets blown up immediately. And then there's, yeah, some basic tower juggling. Good move by the Wolves. And at the other side, top tower was already down. Middle tower didn't get taken. Eventually down the line, this dragon gets picked up by the Unicorns. But overall, in terms of keeping your tempo even, I think this was a good move by the Wolves.
Yeah, they definitely were able to catch the Unicorns unawares and pretty much with their pants down. Freeze and Kass now pushing on this top side. They have got some backup as well, so they really want to kick this game into high gear. Push the Unicorns back even further.
Yeah, we were talking about it. Chachi chunks out Lenny on that Lulu. Freeze can't push in against the wave from Corki, so what do you do? You took the tower in bot lane, you just swap it up. They take another tower here. Good adaptation from the Wolves. Honestly, the first time I've seen them play an early game well with strategy involved. Usually they have decent lane-on-lane situations, but there's no rotations, no towers taken. Right now, they're opening up the map.
This goes back to, you know, them trying to find the new identity with their new teammates, with Lenny and Jesui Kai. They're branching out a little bit. You see Lenny, this is the first time he's been on a utility champion. He's only really played tanks in the first week he was available. We take a look at the early game activity for the Wolves. Normally, it doesn't turn out well in their favor. They usually try to be active, but sometimes backfires.
Yeah, and that's the mark of a team that wants to achieve something, but can't really find any openings strategy-wise, so they just go for fights. They keep on fighting, and they find themselves getting the short end of the stick. Yeah, they get 30 kills, but they sacrifice 45 deaths. So 50% failure rate right there for those fights. And right now they do something different. They play it slow, they recognize their opportunities, and they go for them. And right now they're 2-1 ahead, they're 1,000 gold ahead against Unicorns of Love, and this is probably something people didn't really expect. However, Power of Evil is still scaling, and that's been the game for the Wolf, for the Unicorns this split.
It certainly has. He's working on his tier. He's about halfway stacked up a little bit more than that, but he's going to take some time as he's got the Luden's Echo, still has some solid wave clear for himself. Illisang looking to go on to Sorin, but he's going to get flashed. Sorin staying nice and safe.
So what you have to do against an Alistar, you have to flash mid-headbutt animation. Because a lot of Alistars like spacing it out, as we say before. You headbutt him into the wall, and then knock him up afterwards. So once you get caught, you'll have to flash defensively anyways. And it's fun to flash over that even. You can switch positions with an Alistar too. But yeah, respect flash from Sorin. But a good roam from Illisang. Keep your eyes on Vardax. He's trying to even up that CS. He wants to hit that Triforce. Combine that with the Luden's tier, they could start grouping. Because they vastly outrange the Copenhagen Wolves. The only counter opportunity is speeding up Shook for Body Slam Flash, but his flash is still down.
This is something you mentioned as a possibility in the champion select, when they can possibly group up and utilize the combination of the Corki and the Kog'Maw with that massive front line that they have. It's going to be hard for the Wolves to push them back effectively, dive a back line. Sorin is going to have to laser his way through it all. Hilly goes forward onto Cass. They're just fighting over the wards right now, trying to get as much control of this river as they possibly can. Going to be a while before Dragon's up, but it's never too early to start.
Yeah, I always want to get that vision control down. That's what poke comps are good at, you know, ward wars. Want to see them, defend them, just poke them out. Ever so slowly, one hit at a time. You have the emergency Shen to come in should you need it. Hopefully not for the Unicorn's sake.
He's got both teleports up, I should say. Take a look at the number of Unicorns here on the mid side. The Shen is back and he could teleport right after that freeze. Shook, Jesui Ka all sitting under the tower. It's at about half of its health. And the push will be thwarted for now. Still, fairly even game here, 16 minutes in.
Yeah, look at the top lane. That's what we're waiting for right now. Unicorns. They want to push in, pressure that Lulu, deny her the possibility to come wave clear in mid, and then punish the short range.
Okay, that was an interesting kick, but Kaz is going very low. He has to burn his flash to avoid the last living artillery shell. And this might be an opening for the Unicorns to finish off this mid tower. They've still got the Shen available if they want to use it.
Yeah, look at the zone control and the wave clear on the Copenhagen Wolves' side.
Billy's going in.
Here we go.
Got the Shen coming in on the target out. Sorin, he's going to get blown up. Power of Evil gets the kill credit as Vardax valks away. In comes Lenny, and the fight is on. Looking for the tower, juggling the aggro. Chachi tanking it up as much as he possibly can. Tower still stands, but maybe not for much longer. Without a mid laner there, Kickus goes in. Just a feint. The proc of the Ludens go on to Lenny. It's on! They get it! Chachi will get Lenny. They're still finishing off the tower. Finally polish it down. And that is going to be two kills and an objective in the mid.
The Unicorns are playing around their power spikes right now. They get the Triforce, hit the Ludens, they start the siege, initiate the split push, junk somebody out, and then they set up the dive. And instead of the piggyback Shen right now, it was the bull back Shen right there with Illisang carrying over Chachi. And Illisang using his flash aggressively so that Chachi doesn't have to use his. He could save that later. We saw the pound flash come out, so it was a good move, good dive, and they're punishing the low mobility on the carries from the Copenhagen Wolves. Definitely had to find the right target there. Sorin just got blown up immediately.
Exactly what they needed to do. Let's take a look at that one more time.
So they chunk out Kaz before, and look at Illisang. That's what you have to do on Alistar. Flank. He's got a flash head, but Sorin to the wall. Knock up. His flash is still down from earlier. Remember that roll? It seemed insignificant, but it was enough to get his flash down. And if a Victor is defending a tower without flash, he is prime bait, you know, for that hard engage. And Power of Evil and Vardax are untouched. They can just rain down these missiles over and over. Kiki's cheeky little fake insect. And look at that, max range taunt flash. Good execution here from Chachi. Surprisingly, survives.
Unicorn is doing a fantastic job of juggling all the aggression around on the tower, making themselves not available. 20 seconds until the next dragon is going to spawn. Unicorn did a job of picking that first one up after an ill-fated fight bottom lane. The Wolves have fallen behind once again. This is starting to look a little bit more reminiscent of most of their games this split.
Yeah, and usually the way Wolves fall behind is they lose the lanes a little bit later in the game due to these map-wide plays. And individually, they can't deal with the split pushes and the push and the control anymore. So right now, they're trying to combat that by grouping.
They may be able to take this tower down, but there are a number of unicorns in the area. Chachi here looking for Kaz. Illy goes in, gets polymorphed immediately, and all of a sudden, the Wolves, smelling danger, are trying to bail out. But Soren, he's going to go down. The Chaos Storm, not enough to take out Power of Evil in the solo. And meanwhile, Vardax is on the bottom, continuing to push this unabated. Lenny, Wild Gross himself, Kickus goes in. He's isolated from the team. The Glitter lands. That's going to be it wearing off now. The rest of the Wolves are caught. Chachi gets Kaz. Shook, he's going to go down too. Vardax is still pushing this one. The Wolves are losing everything here.
This is 4v5 by the Unicorns because Soren, he got lost in rotation. He got caught in the jungle right there. And once that main damage is gone, Wolves are on the back foot. And look at the bottom lane. This is the early to mid-game power spike AD carry. One of the two threats on Unicorns of Love. He wasn't even in that fight.
We got one thing wrong. They didn't need to fully group. Grouped everybody but the Corki. Utter Splitpush down the bottom. He takes two towers out. Prime position now to take down the dragon. And the Unicorns just set up a beautiful counter-engage up top.
Honestly, I feel this match gets controlled mostly by Chachi. Because he got that CS advantage even though he got pushed in. He got the early magic resistance which forced the ending in turn Lenny not be able to deal with him anymore, so this freed him up as a resource. Suddenly Chachi was pushing the top lane, he had the couple ultis coming in, good taunt flash, and he's a driving force. He defended that tower aggressively as well. He started everything out because they were trying to chunk the Chen. He's playing a good frontliner, and this is not the carry top laner that we see usually with a lot of damage, but he has finally has some presence. That's what we were lacking on the Unicorns, members with good in-game presence.
Well, Chachi has been one of those top laners who's really liked this Shen. It seems like he's finally now, well, he's had some good games on in the past, but he's definitely making the most of it in this game in particular. And the Wolves are going to have to respect that. They have to take into account his taunt. They have to take into account that he's never far from a fight due to the double teleports. And they don't seem to have an answer for it yet.
Definitely not. And that double teleport, that hard engage is making Soren's life so miserable because both of these carries are low mobility, but one of them, it's a way shorter range, and once you're on the back foot with a victor, it's one of the reasons why we don't really see this pick so often anymore over in Europe. It's so easy to get caught out, you know, especially when you're rotating between lanes, when you're grouping, when you realize you can't really take that tower down. Mm-hmm. Want to move to the next one in the jungle without good vision control, but you feel like you kind of have to make that move because you want to keep up the tempo. It's very easy to get caught out. Look at Lee Sin. Even like a Kog'Maw E slowing you down is enough for the Unicorns to close the gap, and they're very safe at their maximum distance.
This is the Unicorns recognizing the effective threat. We talked about how Soren had not been necessarily up to his former self, but still had the potential to carry in the past. Let's see, they continue shutting down as Kickus is caught. Here comes the Shen.
Ooh, Bimbo!
That got caught instead! Power of Evil, a double kill for him! They're caught in the storm of chaos, but it doesn't matter. Two for none. They look to push on the top side. Unicorns are rolling.
Chachi with the get out of fail free card for his jungler Kickus here. He gets caught, but he can buy himself some time if he can get the Congo line going. Everybody wants to chase Lee Sin, and then you kick one of them and you just play pinball, you knock them all up, and then the Chen comes in, two man taunt, and then, yeah, there's no threat from Power of Evil, so he can reign supreme and just get that artillery down and good combo.
And that's the difference. They keep focusing on Soren. The Wolves can't find Power of Evil because there's too much frontline to deal with. 5-0-3. Power is doing serious work on this Cog. He's close to finishing off that tier. Everything's looking great for the mid laner for Unicorns.
Everything is looking great. However, we have to go back to the early game. It could have looked different here should the Wolves have exploited that early game triple push. I harp on this a lot when I watch League of Legends because I feel if you get into a position where all your lanes get pushed, a good team will just rip you apart. They will just snowball advantage from one move to the other because they can constantly move into the darkness. As we see Hillisang do right there, Vardax gets out. The darkness is your friend if you have vision yourself. You know, obviously you want to just force people make use of the lack of information. They don't know if you're moving from bot lane to mid lane to top lane if you're in the dark. You could be hiding in the brush, you could be threatening the face check, and this forces people to group right now for the Wolves because if they split up, they just don't have enough information to deal with.
No. Like their mascot, Copenhagen Wolves are roaming together in a pack. But will it be enough to catch any unicorns out strain in the open? So far, it hasn't been super successful. The early game that they had built up, completely negated, turned around as it stands. There is a massive gold differential at 23 and a half minutes. I mean, 7,000, the unicorns had turned it on its head just time and time again.
Yeah, pack of wolves. Has there been a name for a bundle of unicorns? Has there been a term for that?
If someone on Twitter mentioned it to me, it is, I'm trying to recall it now, but it was something very magical.
Very magical. Unicorns with that spring split, unicorn dust back on them, finally working in their favor. However, if tradition proves right, today they play well and controlled. Tomorrow might be different.
See if Lenny can get any work done. Cast, they found Kickus right now, but will they be able to take him down? Knocked in, Chachi goes.
Soren,
flash time. Soren, not quite down yet. Soren gets the kill onto Kickus. He much needed gold going into his pocket there, but the unicorns aren't done yet. Lenny has to burn the flash to avoid Chachi. Shen looking to chase them on.
Here's Vardax on the left.
The unstealthiest ninja on the front line. Vardax pinged out by the Copenhagen Wolves. They will have to settle for just pushing the wave for now.
Unicorns need to play with a little more respect and a little more. This wariness of where their AD carry is on the map. Sure, you can 1v4 with Power of Evil, but why don't you just 2v5 instead? And Vardax joined the fray. He still has that Triforce building towards the Blade of the Ruined King. There's a good amount of damage, and they just needed a little bit more to take down Soren. But yet again, he had to use his flash. For the next 5 minutes, these fights are going to be rough for him.
Certainly are. All around the board. For Copenhagen Wolves, this is going to be tense for them to try and make this comeback happen. Soren got some gold in his pocket that'll certainly help him out, working his way towards continuing to upgrade the hex core and also probably working on, I would guess at this point, a death cap, but he's still some items away from it. Maybe he goes for the Zhonya since he has the Amp Tome. Unicorns might not give them an opportunity to finish those builds though.
Yeah, the Wolves, they said, okay, we're playing all in the early game. Because we have this low range Graves in the AD carry role. We have this very low mobility, medium range mage in the mid lane, but these are not picks that do well into poke. As you see right here, Kassi has the face check and he's gone.
No.
They slice off a bit of cheese off the wolf support right here, and then the mobility from the talisman coming out.
Immediately can move forward. Soren will be able to dodge away from the sonic wave, throws down the gravity field. All the same, unicorns continue to march down everywhere they want. The Wolves have no answer still.
Yeah, well, the Wolves had a decent early game in terms of strategy and at least trying to move to different lanes and get some towers. Their drafting phase seems very weak right now because Jason Varus, to my memory, were still up for grabs and he chose the Victor. Even though there were magic damage components on the top lane in the Lulu, could easily match poke with poke and use that scaling mid lane to their advantage to maybe start contesting some brushes. Because I feel like Soren on this Victor is just simply not working out.
No, and he's tried a lot of different mid laners so far this split. You know, you look at it across the board, his Azir's really been his most successful, but that's not what they wanted to trend towards this time around. But Victor is a bit of a head-scratcher, and it hasn't really paid dividends for them. The Unicorns now grouping up, well, at least Vardax and Kickus, to take down Dragon number 3. So far uncontested, that mobility will make it even harder for the Wolves to catch them out.
Yeah, mobility is key, both for and against Pokrumps, and a second key to unlock this monster lock that is the game is the Baron. When you play with poke, you want the Baron to facilitate that because these minions will get so tanky, people will group up closely to try and deal with them. Easy poke. Easy game, easy life. If you're playing against poke, obviously those Baron up minions are going to help you push in and just deny their wave clear so much that you can actually hard engage on them. So Baron is the crux of the game, and it becomes very different as well because we saw over in North America when CLG was playing this low range, low engage type composition into poke, it's very hard for you to secure a Baron buff. And we saw them struggle with that, lose out in the mid to late game, and eventually poke reign supreme. Whereas the Unicorns, they're good at contesting these objectives. They're not good at starting it, because when poke starts a Baron, they're very clumped up, and they're very prone to hard engage. So it becomes a bit of a vision war, and you want to push your lanes up, that's step one. And you want to ward in between the lanes, that's step two. Then you want to push out the lanes again, that's step three, and then you go to the Baron, step four. If you skip any of these steps, you risk throwing the game.
We heard from Sheepy before the game, sometimes they do tend to skip steps. That could be an opportunity for the Copenhagen Wolves to punish them. For now, they are looking very solid, very sealed up. So far, haven't been plagued too much by the consistency issues. But again, it's not always in an individual game. It is game to game. And look at this, the Shen looking to counter jungle, going to eventually go down to the bottom side, push those side waves out. That is one of those steps that they will need to get themselves in position for this Baron.
Yeah, putting the pressure on the bot lane, locking one of those resources from the Wolves down. That's where you want to have the Shen usually, but they're a little scared. Unicorns, they don't want to yield this mid pressure, so that's why Chachi is hovering around mid because he's Power of Evil might get hard engaged on here.
Or Shook might be the one. Kick is going to immediately flash mid barrel, and that is going to be the rest of the Unicorns mobilizing to take him down. Shook is popped by Vardags. And now they're able to get even more off this. Let's see. Straight to the Baron.
No more smite on the side of Wolves. Complete darkness. Oh, darkness, my friend. We meet again. For the Copenhagen Wolves.
They
lose the blue orb to spot them out, but doesn't really reveal too much information, right? Because obviously, Unicorns are doing Baron.
Yeah, they turn their attention now over to Kass, who's going to be getting away. The Baron's still being fired down.
Victor?
There's the Chaos Storm. They got to go in for this one. Kass looks for Vardags. He's burning low. Kass now, he is absolutely massive, courtesy of the Lulu. Hillisang's going to get taken down by Soren. And now the Wolves might have been able to finish this fight off. The Kog'Maw has some serious damage, but Chachi is going to be the one who takes down Soren. A one-for-one. Kick us around the side. Shook his back up, however, let's see if he can get back into the fight. It might be a little bit too late. In comes the Stand United. Down goes the Nautilus. Down goes the Lulu. Unicorns come up again with a victory.
Kikis was stuck in an emergency. Gets the help from his top laner right there. Shook was so close to joining that fight. Almost made it there. And this was what we were talking about. This is the risk when Poke starts a Baron because you clump up. You had the Chaos Storm from Soren come in. Gravity Field zoning. And then Freeze with the massive AoE damage. And right now, they're all low, so Shook, he wants to be a hero.
See if you can. We've seen a couple junglers here in Europe able to pull this one off. They're not zoning him away. They're too low, really. Going to try to keep him in the dark, but this is still a tense moment. Here comes Hilly. He's going to be able to keep his attention occupied for just a minute. Knocks him away. Can they finish it up in time? It's going down. Finally, they take it out, and the game is up. For Shook, never had an opportunity to get the steal off. Still, it's a very tense moment. Kikis got to get away. In comes Lenny all by himself, and he's collapsed on by a blessing of Unicorns.
No Carl to help Lenny, and he goes down all by himself. Not quite sure what he wants to achieve there with that move. But this reeks of desperation for the Copenhagen Wolves. They had a plan in the early game. We can see plan with the early push, but they saw the opening right here. Look at it. Dredge Lion comes out as well later from the Nautilus. Good zoning, and then the Chaos Storm hits four or five people constantly. That's what you want. Look at the massive AoE damage from Freeze as well. He's just a little bit too far behind. I mean, they didn't use that Wild Growth offensively. There was nobody diving into the Unicorn, so that's really what you want when you play Lulu into Poke. You want somebody to close the gap. Use that Wild Growth knock-up and slow to your advantage so you can close the gap. Power Evil is still allowed to play at max range, and he's... Yeah, look at the damage.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
If he lands it.
Wait, there we go.
The Q.
Yeah, Power was able to go on a seek and destroy mission. So Unicorns, Baron in tow, 31 minutes on the clock. Over 10,000 ahead in the bank. Another dragon spawning. They seem to have just about everything in their favor. Even got the side lanes back under control. Wolves, where do they go from here? That's the next question, and maybe back to the base.
Now coming into the game, we said both teams want to prove something. The Wolves want to prove that they made progression. Which, in a sense, in my opinion, they did. They still have a lot of work left, but they laid the first brick of the road. And the Unicorns, they want to make a statement that they're consistent. So let's see how well they're closing. Because obviously, every team in the European LCS statistically is expected to get ahead of the Wolves. How well do you close versus them? 16-4, 3 dragons to 0, 6 towers to 3. So vast advantage from the Unicorns with that Baron. So, essential for your Poke.
Despite it hasn't been a flawless game so far, you're absolutely right. If they can close this one in a clean way and not give the Wolves an inch to get back into the game, that would definitely make a powerful statement that they can handle and they have adapted to their own consistency issues down to the bottom side now, looking to take out Inhibitor Tower number one. They'll get it.
And we talked about Power of Evil and how it would be the PoE show.
Definitely is.
7-0-8, that's 15 added up. I did the math. That's 15 out of 16 kills that he's involved in right now. So Unicorns are playing, as expected, around their mid laner.
Kass nearly goes down. You've just got to respect that living artillery. It's a barrage that they're dishing out on this tower. Running out of minions, however, Kikis tanks up a little bit too much damage, and they back away spooked until the next wave arrives. Dragons up, that's always an option. They look more interested in taking out this inhibitor. No Wolves there to stop them. They back away from it. It goes down. Inhibitor's bare. Time seems to be running out for the Copenhagen Wolves right now. Kass is going in to try and make the hero play. Gets the knockup, gets the second knockup with the Wild Growth. Look for Chachi, baits out Kass. They take him down, they're just too big. The Unicorns looking for the end game here without a support Nautilus to back them up. Four Wolves stand alone.
Yeah, the Gragas ultimate from Shook just wasn't in the right place to knock anybody into the Wolves' team. That's what you want to do with the Gragas. Knock three or three of them back, knock two of them forward, kill them, then take down the next members, but Unicorns get the free disengage from Shook, and then the fight's over. You have to blow them up immediately. They go for Dragon number four, as the top lane is hitting. The minion wave is hitting the tower soonish. Just buys them enough time to control the map. They got a base, spend a lot of gold. They're probably sitting in quite some gold right now. So yeah, 1.4 each, roughly. Quick before they buy.
They've got everything on the map so far. Eight towers to the three of the wolves who have only taken out the first ring of them. All the dragons, the one Baron in this game. All that remains is to try to close this one out and prove, yes, we do deserve to be in the top six.
Yeah, and the Unicorns right now, they were on five wins coming into this game. They were tied with Rocket, tied with Gambit. And in the opening of the show, if you didn't see it, we compared the strength of schedule of the opponents that they were facing. And what we did is we looked at the total wins and losses of the six teams that's remaining. For the Unicorns, they had the easiest schedule, mainly because one of the teams they were facing still was the Wolves. So they definitely confirmed that. They took the easiest victory that they possibly have left, and now they lead to a tied fourth place with Giants, six wins on the board. So if Giants drop a map later, Unicorns are suddenly tied again.
Yeah, they'll be moving on up and see if they can close this one out in style. The Wolves still remaining defiant to the end. Looks like they nearly picked off Kickus, but he was able to bail out some fancy footwork. Chaos Storm doing a little bit of damage to Chachi, but he won't be too worried about that. Inhibitor Tower looking to go down, but all of a sudden Shook makes himself an issue, goes in, gets even bigger thanks to the Wild Growth. Not quite down just yet. Hillisang's caught up in the gravity field, and no one dies, but blinking health bars across the board for both teams. Might drag this game out a little longer as Chachi goes in for round two on the tower.
Yeah, Shook trying to find an opening, desperately so. Chachi, Talon Flash misses.
Not quite enough. Gonna go ahead and send the depth charge his way. Won't be able to polish him up. Inhibitor number three is finally down. The Wolves, now is the time to try and act, to try and get a miracle fight, but they won't be able to find it. The Unicorn slipped free from their grasp yet again.
Wasn't pretty. The inhibitor went down, that's what you came for. You expend some flashes. First we see Kickus go full hero mode over the wall. Realizes, hey guys, I might be a little caught here. So he flashes out. He says, okay, time to shine. Time to make my LCS big play. Sadly connects the body slam. Cask misses. And Chachi's turn, Taunt Flash inwards. But they eventually get what they came for. They get the inhibitor. Three inhibs down right now. Wolves are down, let's see, 12,000 gold. And it's not looking like they have the comeback mechanic they're looking for.
No, and they just haven't been able to do much since that early game. Go back, I want to harp on it again, because these mid laners, it looked so great for Soren to begin with, but the focus they put on him, his lack of range was so effectively punished by the Unicorns, and Power of Evil, his immobility really wasn't. You look at his score, he's extended it. This guy's been a part of almost every kill that they've had this game, and he continues to just consistently pump out the damage. The Wolves have had no answer for him all game, and that's been one of the biggest mistakes, I feel.
Now, I think this game can be looked at, especially going back to the early game, that one play from Hillisang, Q flash with the freeze, shut him down, no BF sword progression into double thorns. I really feel that was the first step for the Unicorns to stay even in this early to mid game, and that's enough. When you look at the compositions, that's all they want to do, stay even Stevens. And honestly, that was the only kill as well that Power Evil was not involved in, and arguably the most important kill this match too. Good opening from Kickus. He was spotted out in his jungle when his lanes were all pushed in. So he was locked down. He had one opening, one shot, one opportunity, and he took it. Unicorns might celebrate with some spaghetti later, but still have to close out this game.
Yep. Still have a little bit of time on the board to do that, but the Wolves are running around scared, trying to save themselves, but Soren will be the first to fall. Cass may be the second, he is. Nexus turrets aren't gonna live for much longer at this rate. All the way back to the towers and freeze is nearly taken down. Hillisang bowls the rest of them back in. Too many minions, too much pressure, and in the end, it's GG to the Unicorns of Love.
All right, Unicorns. You showed a decent early game, a controlled mid game, and a decent, I would argue, even good closing.
Consistent this time. They were able to do the goal that they set out.
And the fans here, full house, seem to really appreciate this victory from the Unicorns. But their biggest task is tomorrow. They have to show up again and make sure that they can show the world that they can go 2-0 instead of these very shaky 1-1 weeks. But they can slightly underperform.
Yeah, they have not had a full 2-0 week for several and a couple of O2s, so this is hopefully for them the start of a trend as they shake hands with the defeated Copenhagen Wolves, who did, I think you're right, they really showed that they have made some progression, but you're right, there's also a lot of work to do. going forward towards the end of this play.
And that makes me wonder, is there going to be enough time for them to progress? Because while SK Gaming is only one win away, SK Gaming has looked vastly superior to them. They just throw at the end of the game. Let's face it, that's what SK does so far. They've been playing phenomenal mid to late games. But then later on, when they're heading, especially around Barrens, they end up losing the game. Copenhagen Wolves, they don't get that far. They play maybe a good early game, sometimes not even that, and then they got shut down. So the team atmosphere wasn't the best, forced to make roster changes, so definitely things that work in their favor, you know, excuses-wise, so it's understandable. But in the end, it doesn't really matter what your reasoning is. If you finish 10th, you're out of the LCS.
Yeah, looking to avoid that one for sure. But for now, Unicorns have added one more tally to the win. Column for them, and looking forward into playoffs, we'll see. They were able to go all the way to second this spring in their debut split. It has been a lot shakier, this split, this time around. But smiles on their faces for now.
Yeah, and man, we usually forget when we talk about the Unicorns because they have such a low kill share, because they have such a low gold share, is Vardax, honestly. Mm-hmm. Rated lower on the list of AD carries. We had a good performance right now. You know, right?
Yeah.
7.7 KDA here. On average, he averaged like 4 KDA. He had a lot bigger kill participation as well, 76% here, because mainly that's what the composition for the Unicorns was about. He wanted to help his team group up with that Corki and that Kog'Maw in the mid game, and that's what I like. They play to their strengths. They waited for him to scale. Obviously, the Corki was picked up early because that's what this metagame is about. Saber Killista out, you pick the Corki, but then you still need to recognize and play around your power spikes and make them work. But I still feel the two key moments in this game were that first blood on Freeze and then Chachi. I think he controlled the early to mid game, the pace, very well. He got that advantage over his lane adversary Lenny, started snowballing, and then he could always ult out aggressively. Usually if you put a Shen under pressure and he's to ult out, you're going to lose something. You're going to lose a tower, you're going to lose two minion waves, but if the Shen is pushing, he has the advantage. He still has the pressure from the wave on one side, he can ult it to the other side, and suddenly you turn the tides. And I think that was very vital on the side of Unicorns of Love.
Yeah, it definitely worked for them at least 9 times out of 10. There was only one or two times where you really thought, well, maybe the Unicorns weren't prepared for this, that early five-man dive by the Wolves.
Yeah.
Springs to mind, but they couldn't keep the pressure up, and that was the issue. They fell behind because they couldn't do what I think you said a lot of better teams can do, is just take the pressure that they have in lanes, translate that to objectives, and just snowball and roll over opponents. It didn't ever happen.
Yeah, honestly, that was the correct move by the Wolves, you know, if you're under pressure and you can't really open up that lock that the Unicorns put on that mid game with, you know, wave clear in the mid lane, that's gone. Wave clear in the bot lane, that's mostly gone by the time that wave hits a tower. Go on the flanks and dive, and when you dive mid lane or bot lane, good setup, honestly.
Yeah.
Good dive by the Wolves on bottom, and then they rotate up Freeze to the top lane, good, get another tower, good snowball. I think if Freeze didn't get caught for that first spot, that move could have been enough to snowball the early game instead of being 1,000 gold ahead. You know, they could have been 2 or 3,000 gold ahead, and suddenly,
yeah,
Soren could have played aggressively, because if you have a gold lead, you open up your zone control. You go forward, and then Soren, he can position in the back a lot better, because now he was forced back. He constantly had to be in the back foot and dodge these tanks, whereas if you're ahead in the game, you can push those tanks around and you have more control. And honestly, it's a very snowbally game right now, League of Legends, because teams are getting better at closing out, and we saw the Wolves, yeah, they started a snowball, but never turned into an avalanche.
Yeah, but this is the thing. When you're a team like the Unicorns, and you know, you're not always able to consistently find an answer, being able to say, okay, there's a Graves that's getting ahead, he's getting shut down. Finally, they're able to realize and recognize and stop that snowball before it became an avalanche on him. So for now, that's all for us. We're going to send it over to the analyst desk. They're going to look